Welcome to my next tip on college writing skills on my series of college writing tips for college, for higher education, and I think for writing in general, actually. My years of teaching at college and university has provided me a lot of knowledge about what's going on in writing within society these days. And one of the things that I've noticed is just how writing has taken a huge downturn. People don't read as much anymore. It doesn't seem like we write as much anymore, even though there's a lot of people self-publishing. I heard today that North Carolina's governor just appointed the new poet laureate from North Carolina. Unfortunately, my feelings about that are kind of negative, because he appointed someone on his staff as the poet laureate, and I'm not really a big fan of people that don't have much of a reputation or you know, a legacy of in publishing taking precedence over people who have spent years and years kind of fine-tuning their skills. And kind of concerns me a little bit. But I just noticed that within the college environment, I just see a lot of kind of not good writing. And my peers are noticing this as well, too. Other faculty are noticing that people, when they show up for classes, show up for school, just really aren't prepared for the rigors of writing within the college and university environment. So, you know, one of the things that the universities are really supposed to be geared towards is raising the bar. You don't want to leave the university with the same level of tools and the same, you know, cognitive abilities that you entered with. We're trying to encourage you and improve who you are, improve your self-esteem, just improve the number of tools in your toolbox. And so it's interesting how many people fight against improving themselves. The university is geared to help challenge you and challenge you to improve your critical thinking skills. And essentially, faculty are our coaches, and we're trying to help coach you in different areas, different disciplines. So that's really what the primary goal here is. I've taught for community colleges. Community colleges have a little bit of a different mission, because they're more geared towards improving skills within a workforce. And so, you know, those skills tend to fall, you know, kind of in a blue collar and kind of a fuzzy blue white collar area, where those skills need to be put to use immediately, like an accounting skills, knowing how to use Excel, knowing how to use Word, knowing how to use hardware, some software, maybe some medical devices, things you need to do for technical type positions. Higher education in some areas, particularly regional schools, tend to fill the gap between what community colleges do in terms of hardening the workforce and training the workforce, and then also kind of lean over into the research side of things too. You know, like what University of Louisville, University of Kentucky, Vanderbilt. So regional universities kind of fall somewhere in the middle between those research schools and the technical type schools. But everybody needs to know how to read. Everybody needs to know how to write. It doesn't matter if you're you know, trying to work on an associate's degree so that you can get promoted, you know, for example, in the maritime enterprise and industry around Western Kentucky and Southern Illinois and Missouri, because those guys on the tugs, the guys on the towboats, if they want promotions, they have to become more educated. And writing is part of that. Is part of the deal. You've got to be doing reports. You've got to keep good logs. You've got to keep good journals. You've got to document people's performance. You've got to document what you're doing for all sorts of government regulations. And so just having good writing skills can make sure not only that you keep your job, but you may get promoted because of the care and the diligence that you take in terms of writing. So this particular video is about explaining yourself. A lot of students, when they write, they think they're writing and they're answering the question, but they're not really. They've read the question, but they're not really hitting the marks as to what the question is really asking for. So let me read you this passage. Geography is important. I live in a town with many industries. Several restaurants serve ethnic food. I see people from different cultures at stores around town. The town doesn't have an airport. If I want to fly somewhere, I can drive to a larger town and use the airport there. Flying from that airport is expensive, though, and there is only a few flights to a couple places. If I want to fly someplace nice, I have to drive a while to a close city. Now, that airport can take me pretty much anywhere I want to go. So let me ask you this. What have I said in this passage? You might say, well, that's not a bad passage. To me, that's an awful passage, and I'll explain why. Because I really haven't said anywhere anything. I haven't really said anything. I've said absolutely nothing. I've put a bunch of words together. I say geography. I say ethnic food. I say airport. I say large town and small town. But I haven't really given this passage any kind of character. I don't even know where I'm at. What kind of ethnic food? What airport? You know, what am I talking about here? A student writing the above for me is likely to get a zero because you haven't told me anything. One of my initial writing assignments that I like to give my geography students is I want them to tell me about the environment in which they live in. Describe the geography of your environment. One day when you're out driving around, tell me what you see. Give me a one or two page essay and tell me what you see. You know, what people do you see? What languages do you hear? Where do your clothes come from? Where is your phone made? What kind of electronic device do you use, and where do you suppose that's made? Where is your car made? But, you know, where is your car made, and where are the parts that come from that, for that car, are kind of two different things. Really pay attention to what goes on around in your environment. Why is your environment growing? Is your environment growing? Is your city growing? Is your town growing? Why? What is causing that? What is the driving force behind that growth? What if it's not growing? You know, why does it seem like your town is stagnant? What set of circumstances arose that your town is maybe losing population or maybe hasn't grown much? Those are the types of things that you need to write about in a writing assignment where somebody asks you to explain yourself. Because there's not a whole lot of examples in the passage that I've given you. So let me read this to you again. I've gone through and I've taken that passage and I've added some things to it, and hopefully it'll sound a little better. Okay, here we go. Geography is important. I live in a small town. It's called Busbyville, Kentucky. Busbyville, Kentucky has a population of about 20,000 people, which supports a variety of businesses and industries. A major auto part maker, Awesome Auto Parts, has a factory here. Their parts are transported by rail all over the United States to automakers and parts supply stores. The Busby County Airport is a local airport with one runway connected to other cities. Connecting to other cities is basically non-existent unless a local pilot is hired. Residents of Busbyville can drive to Paducah, Kentucky, and fly out of Barclay Field to Louisville, Kentucky, or maybe to St. Louis or Memphis. Flying from Paducah can be expensive and the choices of destinations are limited. Busbyville residents often have to drive 2 hours to Nashville. When in Nashville, they can fly from Barry Nashville Airport to cities all over the United States like Atlanta or Detroit. Atlanta and Detroit are common connections for flying to Europe, the Caribbean, or South America. See the difference? You know, I had to put a little bit more effort into it, but now I know where I'm at. I know, you know, what kind of industry is taking place in my town. By the way, Busbyville, Kentucky does not exist. There are Busby towns in the United States, actually, but there's just not one in Kentucky. There's actually one in Tennessee, and there's one in Montana. So that's beside the point. But anyway, that's what I'm talking about in terms of writing. So, you know, this is about explaining yourself. You have to give examples. You have to cite details. Use nouns. Use people, places, things, and ideas when you write. You know, you have a textbook that you probably paid anywhere from $100 to maybe $200 for. Use examples from your textbook. Use examples from the journals that your faculty have given you. Use examples from the reports or the handouts or whatever it is that whatever kind of evidence that you have. Dress it up. Use that stuff. It makes you sound professional. And, you know, because really what I've said in other videos is you're training yourself to be a professional once you graduate. Some of you are already professionals. Some of you already have full-time jobs and you're trying to work on a master's degree. Maybe you're working on a PhD. Maybe you're working on an AA. You know, maybe you're just out of high school and you don't know what to do. You know, maybe I have plans on making some career counseling videos in the future. But the reality is start thinking about yourself as a professional. Put yourself out there as a professional. You may not feel that, you know, internally, I don't know what goes on inside there, but, you know, at least try to exude a little bit of a professional attitude and a presence. Make sure your writing backs that up. Have other people read your writing. One of the things that I've noticed as I've gone through and made these videos and I've been using my blog as a script, I've got to go through and edit some of these blogs and kind of correct some of the grammar. Because even I go through these things and I use spell check and I use a product called Ginger to go through and look at my grammar. But every once in a while, those things will fail. And I've noticed that despite me going through and reading these things numerous times and using products like the word, like the spell check in Word and Ginger, there's still problems in my writing. And that's why editing and things is important. Writing is rarely perfect. I read a lot of books. I read textbooks. I read nonfiction. I read fiction. If you read a lot, you're going to find errors like this. You're going to find errors in consistency and things that don't seem congruent. That's a fact of life. No writing is going to be perfect. But there are some things you can do to eliminate a lot of the common errors and make your writing products look a lot more professional. You don't want to put stuff out there for public consumption that really is a draft. And a lot of people are writing these days. They write it out, they type it up, and they turn it in. That is a draft. You've just submitted a draft. So you don't want to do that. You want to write it. You want to set it aside. You want to read it out loud. You want to have somebody else look at it. You know, if you're talking about a significant work like a 3-page essay, a research paper, you know, it's a very rare person that can write things first the first time. In fact, I don't think anybody actually can. There's no writer, there's no professional writer out there that actually does this stuff, because they will either scrawl it out on a piece of notepad and give it to an editor to have them read, or they'll have a proofreader or a ghostwriter or some team that goes through and evaluates their stuff. Look at the acknowledgments in a book once and look at the list of people in there. Those people have all contributed things and have read portions of work, and so usually writing is not just a solitary, lonely existence. Usually there's a bunch of stuff that goes on out there. A lot of the folks that I follow on Twitter, a lot of the authors and publishers and agents, they all have beta readers. Most of the books that come out these days have been read already by beta readers, either their family, their friends, their professional readers. And so you really have to think about the presence that you want to put out there. So good writing must include examples, real, explicit examples of knowledge. Students have no choice, really. You don't really have a choice in this if you want a good grade, to provide evidence of their knowledge. Faculty are obligated to grade based on the use of examples. If you don't give me examples, I have nothing to grade, so therefore you're going to get a really low grade or potentially a zero. Perhaps the word obligated is too strong. Obligation implies a lack of choice. You do have a choice in everything that you do. Nobody is controlling your actions unless you literally have a gun to your head. You are in control of how you write. You are in control of your education. You are in control of how you approach every task that you do, whether you're brushing your teeth in the morning, writing a short answer essay, studying for an exam. You're in control of the food that goes in your mouth, more or less. You're in control of a lot of things. If you say, well, I don't have control over such and such, well, that probably means that you have given someone else or some agency some other authority, or perhaps maybe you've lost it because of some choices that you've made. That can happen. College students, except for my high school students, are all adults. And so we all have to present ourselves as adults. You have to take responsibility for your own actions. And this is sort of going off the beaten path a little bit in terms of the college writing tips. But too often when I hand papers back, students don't take responsibility. They're like, well, you know, so-and-so was sick or such and such happened and I wasn't able to. You know, we all have stuff that happens in our lives. And so we have to compensate for those things. So you do the best you can with the time you have and the amount of effort and energy that you have to put into it. So students coming out of high school are going to be in for a really significant challenge, because if you've been coddled by teachers and you've been told you're awesome and things like that by your teachers and your faculty at high school or wherever, whatever prep school you've been to, and you get to college and you find out you're just mediocre, that's not good. That's not your fault. That's the problem. That's the fault of the educational system that you came from. So I know I've kind of lectured too much. There's more than I wanted to go into, but you really have to think about education is not simply showing up in a classroom and sitting there and waiting for 50 minutes to expire or an hour and 15 minutes to expire, because you have a choice on how you're going to approach that environment. So, you know, just think about the content, think about your writing assignment, think about your approach, and the other thing that you, some of you might want to think about is welcome to adulthood. So thank you for watching these videos. Like I said, the content of these videos is available on my blog called constantgeographer.com. I welcome any kind of comments, suggestions, I do reply back to you in email if they're, you know, good questions. There's too many trolls and things like that on YouTube, so that's why I moderate. So never be afraid to email or post a comment, because I will try to get back to you if that comment is constructive. Thanks for watching.